It's a pleasure to be here. I'm sort of amazed, as an outsider and a civilian, I'm sort of amazed by the size and sophistication of what you guys do. I'm scared out of my mind, but amazed and impressed, so thank you. My job is a lot more pointless. I spend my life interviewing politicians. I got a good piece of advice when I took my current job, which was to interview three politicians every day. And I can tell you they're all emotional freaks of one sort or another. They have what I call logorrhea dementia, which is they talk so much they drive themselves insane. But what they do have is incredible social skills. If you stand next to them, they'll stand too close to you, they'll rub the back of your head, they'll rub your cheek. I had dinner with a Republican senator a couple years ago, grabbed my inner thigh the whole meal, squeezing it for emphasis. I once saw Ted Kennedy and Dan Quayle years ago meet on the well of the Senate. I was up in the Senate press gallery, and they were friends. They gave each other a big hug, and their faces were like this far apart, and their arms were going up and down each other's backs, and they were sort of bumping and grinding away down there, and I was like, get a room. I don't want to see this. Actually, the king of all this, of course, is the guy you had at this conference last year, Bill Clinton. The story I tell about him, you'll call it name-dropping, but I call it reporting, is that he was coming out of a hotel elevator in Boston. I'm walking through the lobby. He sees me, and he starts praising me for a column I'd written praising him, which he thought was particularly brilliant. And so he comes out of the elevator, and he starts talking to me, but a group of people see Bill Clinton in the lobby, and they want to hear what he says. And so he wants to welcome everybody into his orbit. So he keeps talking to me, but he starts backing up. And within about a minute, he was like 80 feet away from me, but just talking to me, just embracing. And if you don't have these skills naturally the way Clinton does, you sort of fake it. And so I was covering Mitt Romney at his 4 years ago, actually, in New Hampshire. And he was up in New Hampshire campaigning with his four or his five perfect sons, Bip, Chip, Rip, Skip, Lip, and Dip. And he's going into a diner. And he goes into a diner, and he introduces himself to each family at the diner, and he asks them what village in New Hampshire they're from. And then he talks about the home he owns in their village. And then he's going around, and he meets like 30 or 40 people, and he first names everybody he's just met on the way out. And so I'm impressed. And that is the social skills they have. They are socially attuned creatures because they need it to run for office, and they need it to deal with each other. They are an extremely weird bunch of people, and you have to be socially adept to be a successful leader. The story I tell, which illustrates the oddness of the people they have to deal with, is a story Bob Kraft, the New England Patriots owner, tells, which is about going to Russia and seeing Vladimir Putin. And he was part of a business delegation. They go into the Kremlin, and they have a meeting with Putin. And Kraft is wearing his Super Bowl ring. And Putin sees the ring and says, oh, that's an interesting ring. Can I see it? And so Kraft says, sure, he takes it off, hands it to Putin. Putin puts it on his finger and starts gesturing in the meeting and then takes the ring off his finger and slips it into his jacket pocket. And so at the end of the meeting, Kraft goes up to him and says, you know, Mr. President, I'd like the ring back. I'd be honored to make you a replica, but that's the first ring I won for our Super Bowl. It has great sentimental value. And so Putin pretends he doesn't hear him. And so Kraft goes back to the embassy and he says, you know, I didn't want to make a big international incident about it, but could you just send over some feelers to the Kremlin, get my ring back? I would be happy to make them a replica of that ring. And so they send out the feelers and they go to Kraft the next day and they say, you know, we think we're going to issue a press release that you're going to say you would be happy to donate that ring to the Russian people because we can't get it back. And that's what happened. And so the lesson is the world is run by four-year-olds. And you've got to have some social awareness to deal with it. And so the politicians I cover are good at this. They're good at knowing what you think. And yet when they do policy, this social awareness tends to vanish. They talk in the language of cold economics. And in the course of my career, I've covered a series of failures based on this inability to think about how people really are. So I used to cover the decline of the Soviet Union. And we sent economists into the Soviet Union thinking all their problems were economic. But the real problem in the Soviet Union was a lack of social trust. But we couldn't see that because we couldn't measure it. And so everybody stole everything from everybody. And we missed that. In Iraq, we sent the military into Iraq. And I once asked a senior Bush administration figure, didn't you get the culture of Iraq wrong? And this person said to me, you know, I don't really believe in culture. I think if you change the politics, you change the whole society. Well, that was wrong. But they were ill-equipped to think about culture. We had a financial regulatory regime based on the supposition that bankers are rational, self-interested creatures who would never do anything stupid en masse. That turned out to be incorrect. I've covered the education reform for the past 30 years. And we've tried a whole series of reforms, big schools, small schools, charters, vouchers, which are basically reorganizing the boxes. The elemental fact about education is that people learn from people they love. If you're not dealing with that relationship between a teacher and a student, you're not really dealing with education. But if you mention the word love at a congressional hearing, they look at you like you're Oprah. And so I've covered this same problem in issue after issue, an inability to see reality the way it really is. And this isn't only a problem of politics, it's a wider cultural problem. We've inherited a view of ourselves that we're divided. We've got reason over here and emotion over here, and they're sort of on a teeter-totter. If reason is up and emotion is down, and you should try to use reason to suppress your emotion. It's led to the bias that the brain is like a computer, which just sort of transmits information. And this, in reality, has led to an amputation. Where we're really good at talking about material things, we're really bad at talking about emotion. We're good at talking about information, we're bad at talking about things like character. Karl Popper made a great distinction between cloud problems and clock problems. A clock problem, you can take apart into its individual pieces and figure it out. A cloud problem, you can't take apart. It is a whole, a dynamic system. We try to take cloud problems and turn them into clock problems. And this is true in politics, as I mentioned. It's true in child rearing. As a society, we are really good at giving our kids, especially educated kids, great SAT prep, great grades. If you go out to a suburban elementary school at 3 in the afternoon, you'll see these kids in an upper middle class suburbs. They've got their 80-pound backpacks on. If the wind blows them over, they're like beetles sort of stuck there in the ground. They can't get up. And then a creature that you see the cars coming to pick them up at 3 in the afternoon in certain suburbs like Palo Alto near here or Berkeley or Marin County, it's usually a Saab or an Audi or a Volvo because in those suburbs it's socially acceptable to have a luxury car so long as it comes from a country hostile to U.S. foreign policy, that's okay. And so you get these creatures coming to pick them up who in one of my books I called Uber Moms, who are highly successful queer women who've taken time off to make sure all their kids can get into Stanford. And you can actually tell the Uber Moms because they weigh less than their own children. So they're like doing little butt exercises during the moment of conception. In the delivery room, they're cutting the umbilical cord, flashing little Mandarin flashcards at the thing so it can get into Stanford. And on the way home, they stop off to get some socially enlightened ice cream from Ben & Jerry's. I once joked that Ben & Jerry's should make a pacifist toothpaste. Doesn't kill germs, just ask them to leave. It'd be a big seller. Then they stop at Whole Foods to get some socially enlightened baby formula. Whole Foods is one of the progressive grocery stores where all the cashiers look like they're on loan from Amnesty International. Actually, my favorite section in that store is the snack section because they couldn't have potato chips. That would be vulgar. So they have these seaweed-based snacks. What we get in my household, it's called veggie booty with kale, which is for the kid who comes home and say, Mom, I want a snack that'll help prevent colon rectal cancer. And that's a great seller for them. And so the kids grow up as little junior workaholics, because they've been driven from oboe practice to SAT practice. They've been given all the skills to get good grades, to get a good SATs, all the things you can count and measure, but they have not been given some of the fundamental skills of how to be a good person. It's not that they're bad, they're just inarticulate. And it's true even later in life. In my column in the New York Times, I asked people over 70 to send me what I call life reports. And the life reports are, I ask them, evaluate your own life. Give yourself a grade. How did you do at life? And what struck me, I got about 5,000 or 6,000 essays sent to me. And what struck me was how many of the people, age 70, look back on their lives and said, I've never really thought about how I did in life. I never took the time to think about that. And when they evaluated themselves, the first thing you noticed, they gave themselves much higher grades for their professional lives, which tended to be A minuses or so, than from their personal lives, which tended to be B minuses. And you had a small minority who basically sat down and had a vocabulary to think about the deepest and most important things in their lives. And they did certain things because they had the ability to talk about it. One, they divided their lives into chapters. They said, there are six key phases of my life. This is the beginning of a key phase. Here's what I'm going to do in this phase. They artificially divided time into chapters. Another thing is they leaned toward risk. A theme in all these essays was people vastly regretted the stuff they didn't do rather than the stuff they did. The other thing they learned is you can't control other people, and they learned to tolerate the differences in other people around them. But this was a minority. Most people lacked the vocabulary. And so what I've described so far is this amputation in the policy world and child rearing, just in life. Bad at thinking about the things that matter most. Bad in using what our brain has to its fullest extent. And so I'm covering all this, and I see a breeze blowing the other way. A group of researchers who are filling me in on exactly the things the rest of the culture is missing. How to think in a full sense, not only with pure reason, but with all the things the brain has the ability. And the odd thing is the people who are thinking in this full sense are not theologians or philosophers. They're cognitive scientists. They're neuroscientists. They're behavioral economists. They're studying the mind. And so we're in the middle of this revolution, understanding how we think, especially in this city and in this area. And they're giving us really two ways. What they're giving us is a new view of human nature based on three foundational principles. The first foundational principle is that while the conscious mind writes the autobiography of who we are, most of our thinking is unconscious. The human mind can take in 12 million pieces of information a minute, of which it can be consciously aware of 40. We have two systems going on at the same time to help us understand the world. The logical, linear, rational one, which is the voice in our head. The associative, intuitive one, which is down below awareness. And most thinking is below awareness. And this leads to peculiarities. So if you eat alone, you eat on average this much. If you eat with one other person, you eat on average 35% more. If you eat with three or more other people, you eat on average 78% more. You don't think about this, but your unconscious uses sociability as a way to relax. Golf. Somebody did a study of 2.5 million putts on the PGA Tour. Golfers of all abilities, from all distances, putt more accurately when putting for par than when putting for birdie. And that's because they fear the bogey more than they desire the birdie. We fear failure more than we desire success. It's called loss aversion. Parole boards. In Israel, parole boards give prisoners 6 minutes to present their case on whether to get parole. And they grant parole in 35% of cases, except for in the hour after breakfast and lunch. Then they grant parole in 65% of cases. If you're applying to med school, you want your application to be reviewed on a sunny day rather than a rainy day, because admit rates are much higher on a sunny day than a rainy day. These are all subtle ways unconscious processes change who we are. In New York City, where I used to live, they make McDonald's put the calorie counts up on the menus, thinking people will see the calories, and then they'll order fewer of them. They won't be so fat. After they put the numbers on the menus, the calorie count per order went up, not down, because people were attracted to the higher number. And so these are ways, it's called priming. And so these are the ways the unconscious changes behavior. And sometimes the unconscious is incredibly stupid. The unconscious is really bad at math. But in some ways, the unconscious is quite smart. So one of the most cognitively demanding things we do is buy furniture. It's really hard to go in a furniture store, look at a sofa, and figure out how it'll look back in your own living room. And so they study, what's the best way to make this decision? You should not make a list of the pros and cons of the sofa. What you should do is study the sofa, be around it, sort of be with it, and then distract yourself and go with your gut several minutes later. Because what the unconscious is really good at is pattern recognition. All the complicated things that go into a pattern, it can figure out whether it'll look good in your sofa, in your living room. And so one of the scientists gave me a bit of advice, which is if you have trouble making up your mind between two options, flip a coin. Tell yourself you'll settle it by a coin flip. But don't go by whether the coin came up heads or tails. Go by how you emotionally reacted to the coin flip. Are you happy or sad? That's what you actually want. And so that's the first principle. Most thinking is below awareness. The second thinking is that emotion is at the center of our thinking. People who can't process emotion are not super smart Mr. Spocks. They're super dumb. There's a guy at USC who studies, named Antonio Damasio, who studies people with lesions who can't process emotion. They can't make intelligent decisions. They ruin their lives. They can't even reach a conclusion. Because emotion is your valuation device. It assigns value to things. And if you can't assign value to things, you can't make a decision, even on math or on anything else. Now, I'm a middle-aged guy. My wife says that me writing and talking about emotion is like Gandhi writing and talking about gluttony. It's not my natural thing. One of my favorite, though, apocryphal brain scan stories concerns a bunch of guys. They put them in a brain scan machine. They had them watch a horror movie. And then they asked them to describe their feelings about their wives. And the brain activity was the same in both activities. It was just sheer terror. And so I'm like that. I'm not good at talking about emotion. But emotion tells you what to remember. Emotion organizes how you make judgments, and emotion literally wires the fibers of the brain together. In the late 40s, they had an orphanage in the West, in I think Nevada, where they decided the way to keep kids healthy was to give them health care, give them food, but not to touch them, so you don't spread germs. The mortality rate by age 3 was 38%, because without the touching and the affection, the brain literally did not form. It wired the fibers of the brain together. And so emotion really is central to cognition. The third insight is that we're not primarily self-contained individuals. We're deeply interpenetrated one with another. We have these things called mirror neurons. When you see me shoot a free throw or drink a glass of water, your brain looks like you yourself are doing that. We don't only observe each other, we imitate each other all the time. And we're deeply interconnected in ways we're not even aware of most of the time. So, for example, smell. We barely think of smell, but we are constantly evaluating each other by sense of smell, and people who lose the sense of smell suffer greater emotional deterioration than people who lose any of the other senses. There was a study done in Germany where they took gauze pads, taped them under people's arms, and then had half the research subjects watch a comedy and half watch a horror movie. And then they took off the gauze pads and had another group of research subjects who were presumably well-paid sniff the gauze pads. And they asked them, which movie did this person watch? And people could tell at way above average chance what movie they watched by the smell. And women were a lot better than men at this. And so these are the foundational principles, the power of unconscious thinking to organize how we see the world, the power of emotion to help us render judgment, and the deep interpenetration of people. And this gives us an entirely different view of who we are. We're inheritors of the French Enlightenment Descartes view that our most prime activity is reason and rationality. But the people who were right were not the French Enlightenment, they were the Scottish Enlightenment of David Hume, who said we have sentiments, and our sentiments are quite strong. And so this is a different view of reality, and a different view of what it takes to do well in life, and a different view of human capital. We're used to thinking about SAT scores, educational attainment, and IQ. And that stuff is important. There's no question about it. IQ explains about 25% of the variation in job performance, somewhere 25, 30%. So it is important. It's the single most important thing. But that means two-thirds or three-quarters of job performance or variation is explained by other stuff. And this research suggests there are other talents and traits that, in combination, are much more important. And what are these talents and traits to doing well? The first is mindsight, the ability to enter into other people's minds and share and to learn what they have to offer you. This is not a universal trait. Some people are better learners than others. Now, babies come with this facility. Alan Meltzoff, a scientist at the University of Washington, leaned over a baby in 1979 who was 43 minutes old. He leaned over her, he wagged his tongue at her. She wagged her tongue back. Babies at 43 minutes old don't know what a tongue is or a face or a nose. They just know they're supposed to mimic. And that's how they learn. And so they begin mimicking. And by 18 months, some babies are fortunate enough to have developed a secure relationship with their moms because they've had a two-way communication. They've learned to mimic her, and she's mimicked back. And scientists can predict at 18 months, with 77% accuracy, who's going to graduate from high school based on this ability to have a relationship with mom. And 55% of kids in this country have established this kind of relationship. 18% are what they call avoidantly attached, which means they've sent signals to mom, but mom hasn't sent anything back for whatever reason. And those kids have a difficult time in school because they don't know how to build a relationship with teacher. One of the teachers I talked to described those avoidantly attached kids walking into a classroom like a sailboat tacking into the wind, wanting to get close to teacher, not knowing how to do it. Even at age 70, people who are avoidantly attached at 18 months have 2/3 fewer friends. Now, nothing that happens that early on is going to determine a life course. Something else can happen that can countermand it. But pathways are opened up because of the way the brain is formed. And some people have this ability to immediately relate. I was in LA recently. I met Michael Milken of 80s fame. He's one of those guys who just locks into you, and if you have information, he's going to get it out of you. He just has that facility. The second trait that's tremendously important is equipoise. That's the ability to monitor your own shortcomings, the shortcomings of your own thinking process, what the scientists call metacognition. For example, we are overconfidence machines. 95% of college professors believe they have above-average teaching skills. Time magazine recently asked Americans, are you in the top 1% of earners? 19% of Americans are in the top 1% of earners. And another 35% expect to be next year. Paul Schumacher and Edward Russo gave tests to executives about their own industries and then asked them, how well did you do on the test? People in the advertising industry gave answers they thought were 90% correct. In fact, they were 60% wrong. The most overconfident industry in the world is the technology industry. In this industry, people thought their answers were 95% correct. In fact, they got 80% of the answers wrong. This is a strongly gender-linked trait. Men drown at twice the rate as women because men have tremendous confidence in their ability to swim after they've been drinking. And so we tend to be overconfident. But some people have the ability to be aware of this overconfidence. They tend to be open-minded in the face of ambiguity. They adjust the strength of their conclusion to the strength of the evidence. They're modest in the face of partial knowledge. And these abilities are not really correlated very well with IQ. They're different cognitive abilities below awareness. And then some people have the ability to build modesty bootstraps for themselves. One I read about recently was called the premortem. Before you make a decision, write a short story in which you imagine your decision went disastrously wrong. Because we tend not to think about these things, but it'll remind you how bad things could turn out. Another is a Peter Drucker bootstrap, which is every time you make a decision, write down your decision and your reasoning, seal in an envelope, open it in 9 months, and then open it up. You'll see that a third of your decisions were right, a third were wrong, a third in the middle, but in almost all cases, your reasoning will have been completely irrelevant to how it turned out. And so those are modesty bootstraps. A third trait is called metis. That's a Greek word, which is basically the ability to detect the essential patterns in a landscape, to be sensitive to the physical environment. My newspaper a couple of years ago did a story about soldiers in Iraq who could look down a street in Baghdad and tell whether there was an IED, a landmine in the street, buried somewhere. And if you asked them, how do you know? They could not tell you. They just said, I feel a coldness inside. And that's because after long and close observation, they had developed unconscious pattern recognition skills. In chicken farms, they have these people called chicken sexers who pick up the new chicks and tell whether they're male or female. They're phenomenally good at it. But if you ask them how do they know, they couldn't tell you. They just somehow know. And that, again, pattern recognition skills. And so this is an unconscious trait that comes from close observation. A fourth trait is sympathy, a sensitivity to the social environment. And this comes in handy at work because most of us think work in groups, because groups are tremendously good at certain things. They're not good, by the way, at brainstorming. Coming up with ideas is not something groups do well. There's been a bunch of research about this very recently, and groups that try to brainstorm together do much worse than groups that brainstorm separately and then come together to discuss the product of the brainstorming. Nonetheless, in general, groups are smarter than individuals, and face-to-face groups are smarter than groups that meet any other way. So, for example, the University of Michigan did an experiment where they gave different groups math problems, and some groups met 10 minutes and met face-to-face, and they could solve the math problems with no problem. It was easy for them. Other groups had 30 minutes, but they had to communicate by email, and they could not solve the problems. They tended to break up. So beware teleconferencing. Face-to-face groups are much better than teleconference groups, and that's because the intelligence of the group is not determined, what they call the group IQ, is not determined by the average IQ of the member or the IQ of the smartest member. It's the emotional sensitivity of one member to another. How often do they take turns? How well do they read each other's body language? And that's something you just do a lot better face to face. And that too is a sort of skill. Another skill is to be aware of your own conscious biases. We all have what they call heuristics, things that we tend to do, which generally we shouldn't do. Mental habits, which sometimes serve us and sometimes don't. There's a great website called edge.org, which had a symposium of these biases that we should be aware of. And some of the biases that the scientists talked about were things like path dependence. That which seems normal may have just been a historical accident. We take it for granted, but we shouldn't just because it happens to exist. The most famous example of that is the QWERTY keyboard. It happens to exist because when they designed typewriters for the first time, they needed something that would be very slow, so the typewriter wouldn't jam. And now we're forever after stuck with this slow, inefficient keyboard. A second bias is called the focusing illusion. And that is the bias, and the truth is that nothing is as important as it seems when we are thinking about it. And so, for example, education has a lot to do with inequality in this country. And yet, if you equalized educational outcomes, you would still reduce the total inequality in the country by less than 10%. And so we think about education a lot, and because we think about it, we think it's really important. But that doesn't mean it is really important. There are probably a million other things that contribute. The third bias we tend to have is a famous one for psychologists called the fundamental attribution error. And that is to ascribe to traits, to character, things that are really caused by situation. So for example, when we're in a rush at the supermarket and we butt in line to get in first, we think, well, I'm in a rush. It's my situation. When somebody else does it, we think, oh, he's an asshole. And so we ascribe to them character traits, but it's really caused by situation. Finally, there's the planning illusion. This is the bias, which many of us have, where we don't step outside our situation to evaluate what the real probabilities are. Danny Kahneman, who has a great book out called Thinking Fast and Slow, describes a time when he was designing a curriculum in Israel. And he was part of a committee to design a psychology curriculum for Israeli textbooks. And they'd worked on it for about a year, and he went around the room at one meeting and said, how long do you think it'll be before we finish? And everybody guessed, and they thought, oh, we'll probably finish in another year. It'll be a two-year project. But there was one fellow in the room who'd done this, you know, dozens of times. And Kahneman turned to him and said, well, how long do most committees take? And the guy said, you know, I've never really thought about it, but I guess I've never heard of a committee finishing in less than 7 years or in more than 10. And they all heard this fact, and they said, oh, that's ridiculous. We'll be done in a year. And they proceeded as if this fact had no material relevance to them. In fact, it took them 9 years. And by the time they were done, the Israeli government had lost interest and they never adopted the curriculum. And so people do not step outside. The fifth trait that is more unconscious is propriety. The ability to see the world in ways that maximize your self-control. The most famous experiment in this whole field was done by a guy named Walter Mischel. It's very famous, some of you probably know it, called the marshmallow experiment. And very briefly, Mischel took four-year-olds, put them in a room, and put a marshmallow on the table in front of them. And he said, you can eat this marshmallow now, but I'm going to come back and say 15 minutes. if you haven't eaten the marshmallow, I'll give you 2 marshmallows. And you can go online and watch the videos of the kids trying not to eat the marshmallow. There's a little girl banging her head on the table, trying not to eat the marshmallow. There's a little guy, one day Michelle's using an Oreo cookie. Little guy picks up the Oreo, carefully opens it up, carefully eats out the middle, and carefully puts it back on the table. And that kid is now a US senator. But the scary thing is that 20 years later, the kids who can wait 7, 8, 10, 12 minutes have much higher college completion rates, and 30 years later, much higher incomes. A lot of the kids just pop the marshmallow right in their mouths in 1 minute. Those kids have much higher drug and alcohol addiction problems and much higher incarceration rates, and this by age 4. And that's because some kids have grown up in homes where actions lead to consequences, and they've developed strategies to control their impulses. Basically, they've learned to look away. And some kids have not developed those strategies. And if you can't do that, school will be frustrating and your life outcome will be worse. And that's the sort of internal architecture that either gets built up or it doesn't get built up. And again, it doesn't have to happen right away. It's better if it happens young, but if it doesn't, it can happen later. There's a book, a great philosopher that I highly recommend, who writes about baseball, a guy named A.E. Dorfman. He wrote a book called The Mental ABCs of Pitching, and it's all about mental discipline. It's you walk on the mound in the same way every day. You prepare in the same way every day. If you're on the rubber and you're thinking about, you should have 3 things you should be thinking about: the pitch selection, the pitch location, and the velocity. If you're thinking about something other than those 3 things, step off the mound. And it's all about building a rigorous architecture around your thought processes. And his hero was the retired pitcher now, Greg Maddux. One day, Dorfman goes up to Maddux at the end of an outing, and he said, "How'd you do?" And Maddux said, 73 out of 78. And that meant the ball left my fingers correctly 73 out of 78 times. Everything that happened to the ball after it left his fingers was out of his control, and therefore it was irrelevant. So he just cared about how the ball left his fingers. And so that's the way you build an external substructure, an architecture, around your thought processes. And some people have this facility, and some people don't. And then the final trait, which again is mostly unconscious, is something I call limerence, which is not really a drive, it's a motivation. What the conscious mind hungers for is money, success, and prestige, all the things that the magazines write about. But what the unconscious mind hungers for are those moments when self-consciousness fades away, when you forget who you are and you're lost in something. This happens when a craftsman is lost in the craft of the job. Maybe a software writer is lost in the task of writing software, when a carpenter is lost in the task of carpentry. It happens when a naturalist is at one with nature. It happens when a believer is lost in God's love. And it happens when we're lost in the relationship and friendship or the sports teams we have and we love and we partake in. It's those moments when self-consciousness fades away. That is the thing I think that fundamentally motivates people. After the social network movie came out, they tried to describe why these people were so in love with writing code. Zuckerberg said, "They don't get it. We love it just because we love it. We love the activity. It's not only the money." But I think that is what motivates people, the desire to be lost. And so that's the fundamental unconscious drive that drives people to work so hard. In all the course of research, we've learned a lot about what makes people happy. And money does correlate a little to happiness. Though it tends to tail off. You get the richer you get till you get to be about upper middle class, you get happier the richer you get. But then after a little while, it pretty much stops. Sudden bursts of wealth, nothing. If you win the lottery tomorrow, you will have 6 good months of happiness. After that 6 months, you'll be back to your normal level. If, on the other hand, you get hit by a bus and you're paralyzed, you'll have 6 bad months, but after those 6 months, you'll be back to your normal level. So money and physical things barely relate to happiness. Age does have a correlation to happiness. People are quite happy in their 20s, and then they tend to go through a shallow U-shaped curve, and they hit the bottom of that curve, on average, at about age 47, and that's called having teenage children. But then it starts to go up, And the happiest years in life are the 10 years after retirement, usually 65 to 75. And that's not only because people are free, also they see things in a happier way. They perceive the world differently. So if you show a crowd of faces to a person in their 30s or 40s, the eyes will focus on the unhappy or threatening faces. For a senior citizen, their eyes focus on the happy faces. They're less concerned about threat, more like, hey, what can I enjoy? So these things have relationships to happiness. But the single most important relationship to happiness is love, is relationships. How strong your friendships are, how strong your marriage is. I tell college students all the time, if you have a great career and a crappy marriage, you will be unhappy. If you have a great marriage and a crappy career, you'll be happy. Every course you take should be about who you're going to marry. You should really think about this. They don't listen to me. But it is true. One study in Britain suggested that having a successful marriage produces the same happiness gain as earning $100,000 a year more. Joining a club that meets just once a month produces the same happiness gain as doubling your income, just having that regular group of people. And it is these connections that the unconscious is really most in charge of. Data is really important about a lot of things, but I would not choose a friend on the basis of data, because the unconscious is doing sophisticated analysis such as you cannot imagine when choosing a lover or a friend. When two people go on a date, the amount of mental activity is phenomenal. Some of it we're not even aware of. Guys, we're beasts, so we tend to like women with a 0.7 waist-to-hip ratio. We don't think about that, but that we tend to like that and have through all history. If you go back to from Egypt till today and look at portraits of beautiful women, they have the same ratio. Women, unfortunately, like men of high status. And in our society, that correlates to height, sadly. Though I did see a great study of online dating sites, and they found that a guy who's 5'6" can get as many online date offers as a guy who's 6', so long as he makes $172,000 a year more. And so, I don't know why that interests me, but it did. The other thing we look for is similarity. Eyes similarly far apart, we tend to marry people with eye width similarly far apart. We tend to marry people with noses similarly far apart. We tend to marry people with complementary immune systems. And you can tell whether a relationship is going to work out by how well a couple synchronize with one another. So you can actually do this research with people on their first dates. Are they breathing at the same paces? Are the words coming out at the same paces? We do this with all our conversations, no matter where we are. Are they synchronizing their vocabularies? So linguists look at this a lot. So for example, at different IQ levels, we have different vocabularies we use. People with an 80 IQ will use words like fabric, enormous, and conceal. But they will probably not use words like sentence, consume, and commerce. And so people can detect what IQ level the vocabulary is at, and if they're good at building relationships, they synchronize those things. And so those are the sorts of things that lead to love and eventually lead to these powerful feelings where you forget who you are, you fall in love with one another, you build a relationship, which is when the self-consciousness fades away and the unconscious mind is at its happiest. Now, I ran across, in the course of my reading for this book, I ran across a really beautiful, though sad, explanation or a feeling of what it's like when one mind interpenetrates with one another. And it was written by a guy named Douglas Hofstadter, who's a scientist at Indiana University, and he wrote it in his book called I Am a Strange Loop. And Hofstadter's a cognitive scientist, and he was on sabbatical in Italy. And he's out there with his family, his wife Carol, and their two kids, who were then age 5 and 2. And while he's on sabbatical, Carol suffers an aneurysm and dies. And he comes back, but then they return to Italy, finish the sabbatical, and he has a picture of Carol on his bureau in his bedroom. And he probably sees that photograph every day. But one day, a couple months after her death, he saw with particular attention. And here's what he wrote about that moment when he looked at her photograph. I looked at her face, and I looked so deeply that I felt I was behind her eyes. And all at once, I found myself saying, as tears flowed, that's me, that's me. And those simple words brought back many thoughts that I had had before about the fusion of our souls into one higher level entity, about the fact that at the core of both our souls lay our identical hopes and dreams for our children, about the notion that those hopes were not separate or distinct hopes, but were just one hope, one clear thing that had defined us both, that welded us into a unit, the kind of unit I had but dimly imagined before being married and having children. I realized that though Carol had died, that core piece of her had not died at all, but that it had lived on very determinedly in my brain. And so the Greeks used to say we suffer our way to wisdom. And the wisdom that Hofstadter suffered his way to is that we have these loops in our brain that flow constantly, one person to another, one colleague to another, one spouse to another. And we exist in those loops as sort of the way the fish exist in water. And those loops are based on connection, they're based on sympathy, but most germane for actually for the people in this room is they're based on trust. Trust is the most fundamental building block for a society. You can measure how well a society is going to do by whether people trust each other or not. I mentioned the Soviet Union at the beginning of my talk. I used to go into the bedrooms there, and go into the living rooms and go into the apartments, and they'd be really nice. This was back in the Soviet days, or just after. And then you go out in the hallway, there'd be like four doorways around the elevator, and it would smell of urine, the lights would be out, and it would be filthy. And you'd say to the people, why don't you clean up your hallway? And they'd say, well, so-and-so's a drunk, so-and-so I don't like. But the reality was that after 70 years of totalitarianism, they didn't know who was KGB, they didn't know who they could trust, they didn't know who they could establish an association with. And that is tremendously damaging for an economy when you don't know who you can establish an association with. In Italy, in southern Italy, there's a famous study done by a guy named Edward Banfield who looked at the levels of trust and the networks of trust. And in southern Italy in those days, this was decades ago, people had great trust for people in their own family, but they did not trust people outside the family. And so they'd start a company, and the company would grow until it employed all the people in the family, and then it would stop growing, because they didn't trust anybody outside, and so the companies just stopped, because they didn't have that level of trust. What we have in this country is a quite high level of social trust. We have my favorite Western is a movie called The Searchers, but the most accurate Western is a movie called My Darling Clementine, which was also directed by John Ford. And it's about Wyatt Earp, Henry Fonda plays him, but it's not about the shootout at the OK Corral, it's about how you build trust in a town. The sheriff comes in, the teacher comes in, they put up a church, a dentist comes in. They build trust, and they build a community. And it's the network of trust that creates the wealth. Trust is wealth. And so one of the things that we're under threat now is a decline in trust. We have a decline in trust in institutions. In my business, 70-80% of Americans used to think government did the right thing most of the time. Now it's not 70 or 80%, it's 11%. We have a decline in trust in companies, in all institutions except maybe the military. And what the people in this room do is help battle that back by creating a sense that I can go online and trust basically what's about to happen to me. And believe me, I'm your worst nightmare in terms of my passwords. But that is so important in keeping a society healthy. And I sometimes think that we are in a perilous state about that. When you look at the level of distrust and anger and hostility in the society, you really can become quite pessimistic about where the country is going. But you just have to trust that people like you are going to help build trust. And you have to trust the essential connections that we have as Americans, the unconscious connections, are stuff that's going to last. And I always say, if you want to understand America, go to a Home Depot, watch a man buy a barbecue grill. That's when he's most emotionally exposed. He's going to buy the Weber Genesis grill, the 942-inch grill surface in case he gets the urge to roast a bison. Takes it out to a big box mall out in the, you know, his suburban, takes it out to his Yukon. XL loads the barbecue grill. There's sort of a PetSmart over here across the parking lot, a Bed Bath & Beyond over here. Along the highway, there are all the suburban theme restaurants, which if they merged, would be called Chili's, Olive Garden, Hard Rock, Outback Cantina over here, then the Walmart over here, and my favorite store, which is the Costco, which is like Walmart on acid. Because it's here you can buy your 60-pound bags of detergent, your boxes with 190 pounds of tater tots. I always go to these stores thinking, you know, who comes here shopping for condoms? Because the quantities are so enormous. And so that's the thought I'd leave you with, that there are a lot of optimistic people in America, but they need your security help to keep them going. So thank you very much.